you just question that, and you're not sure, is everything that we believe about Jesus really true? Did he really rise from the dead? Maybe for you, though, the big question is more, is it worth it? I mean, when you look at the Christian life and you just wonder, is it really worth it? Is it worth the struggle? Is it worth the sacrifice? Is it worth it? And we're going to talk about these kinds of doubts today as we continue with our series, God is Greater. Let me just pray again for our time here in the Word. Father, we just pray right now, Lord, as we open your Word, God, that you would speak to us, that you would bring it alive, that you would, God, show us how you want to mold us and shape us with your Word now, and especially, God, as we bring our doubts to the surface and before you today. God, I pray that our hearts will be open to what you have for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. It's baseball season, which is great, right? Awesome. I love the spring. So it's time to talk a little bit of baseball here. If you're a baseball fan, then you've probably heard of a guy named Bill Buckner, right? A lot of you guys, maybe if you're young, you don't know who Bill Buckner is. But Bill Buckner, this is Bill Buckner. Bill Buckner was one of the top players in the 1970s and even into the mid-80s. He had a 22-year major league career, okay? His lifetime batting average was .289. He hit over 300 eight times in his career. He won a batting title, which means highest batting average in the league, in 1980 with a .324 batting average. He was an all-star. He twice led the league in doubles. He accumulated 2,715 hits in his career. He was one of a small number of players who had 200 hit seasons in both leagues, the American League and the National League. In 1985, he set the major league record for assists by a third baseman in a season with 184. His career fielding percentage was .991, which means 99.1% of the time he makes the play that he's supposed to make without an error. That's more than 99 times out of 100 he makes the play. That's a stellar career in the major leagues. And yet, what is Billy Buckner known for? Anyone? Exactly. That one time that he didn't make the play. This is it. 1986 World Series, it was Game 6 against the New York Mets, and he let a ball go through his legs, which allowed the Mets to not only win that game, but then they go on to win the series. And that play has haunted him for the rest of his life. History has not been kind to Bill Buckner. Now, there's a guy in the Bible named Thomas who deals with very much the same issue in his life. Okay, history has not been kind to Thomas. Thomas was one of the original 12 disciples of Jesus, handpicked by Jesus to be one of the first 12 disciples. And he wasn't half-hearted about following Jesus. In fact, in John chapter 11, Jesus is talking to his disciples. He says, hey, we're all going to go back to Judea. Okay, Lazarus, he heard Lazarus was sick. We know Lazarus ends up dying and Jesus raised him from the dead. But they were going to go back there because they had caught word that Jesus' good friend Lazarus was sick. So he says, we're going to go back there. The disciples object because they're like, we can't go back there. Because last time we were in Judea, the crowd went against you, and they almost arrested you, and we just think something bad's going to happen if we go back to Judea. And you know, it's Thomas who stood up and said, you know what, guys? Let's go die with Jesus. That was Thomas. Like, let's go die. If we go back there and something bad happens, let's go and let's go die with Jesus. Thomas was not half-hearted. Later on in Jesus' last week before the cross, Jesus was telling his disciples, hey, I'm going to a place, I'm going to prepare for you, right? He's talking about heaven. And he goes, and where I'm going, you're going to be able to come too. And it's Thomas who stood up and said, but how do we get to where you're going? How do we get there if we don't know where you're going? You see, Thomas, he may not have understood everything perfectly, but he was not a half-hearted follower of Jesus. He had a strong desire to follow Jesus, and he was ready to go for whatever was going to be ahead of them. And yet, what was he best known for? his doubt. He was known for his doubt. About 18 hours after Thomas asked about where Jesus was going, Jesus dies on the cross. And when that happened, the disciples scattered. They were scared. And you know, they didn't know what was going to happen to them. And really, none of them showed much devotion to Jesus at that point, even Thomas. But it's hard to really blame them for that, right? I mean, come on. I think a lot of us probably would have responded the same way. They didn't know what was going to happen. They're figuring, well, they just killed Jesus. What are they going to do to us? What's going to happen next? But we know that the grave couldn't hold Jesus. We know that death had no power over him. We know, as we talked about a couple weeks ago, that Jesus is greater than death and that he rose from the grave. And when that happened, he began to appear to some of his followers. He appeared to Mary Magdalene and a couple of the other women. Then a couple followers on the road to Emmaus. He appeared to Peter, and then a group that included all of the disciples except Thomas. They were all there except Thomas, and Jesus appeared to them and was interacting with them and talking with them. We don't know where Thomas was. Who knows where Thomas was, but he wasn't there with the rest of the group. So later, when the other disciples are telling him about it, he's just like, no way. They're all pumped up. They're all excited. Jesus is alive. And he's just saying, no, I don't believe it. That can't happen. That doesn't make any sense. We all saw him die on the cross. We know he was put in that tomb. He just can't be alive. And I'll tell you, unless I see it for myself, and not only see it for myself, I want to touch the holes in his hands. And I want to put my hand in his side where they stabbed him with that spear. And until I do that, I'm not going to believe. Case closed. From that point on, he's been referred to throughout history as what? Doubting Thomas. We use it as a phrase. Don't be a doubting Thomas. You're such a doubting Thomas. Poor Thomas. But come on, there's lots of us who would have responded the same way as Thomas did. In fact, there's a lot of people who respond to Jesus the same way today. Maybe that's you. Maybe you came in here today and you're just not completely sure. You're not completely sold on the fact that everything we read about Jesus is true and that he's alive today and that he's coming back to get the church, take us to heaven. Maybe you're feeling that way this morning. I just want to assure you, if that's you this morning, that's okay. That's okay. It's okay that you have doubts. God is not afraid of your doubts. Okay? He's not afraid of your doubts. In fact, God is greater than your doubts. He's greater than your doubts. He's not mad at you that you have them. Here's the thing. He just wants you to bring them to him because he wants to help you sort through them. When your doubts become a problem is when you let it drive you away from God and you let your doubts turn into denial. That's when they become a problem. But God's not scared off by the fact that you have doubts, that you have questions, that you're saying, I'm not quite sure. That's okay. Bring them to him. In fact, let's look at how he dealt with Thomas's doubts. Look at John chapter 20. John chapter 20. And we're going to start reading in verse 24. It says, now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we've seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the marks of the nails and place my fingers into the marks of those nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. That's a strong statement. So 8 days later, so for a week he kind of carried that around and got to see all the other disciples all pumped up and excited and celebrating. And for 8 days he's just going, I'm not buying it. I just don't believe it. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again. But this time, Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your fingers here. See my hands? And put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. And guess what? That's us. Isn't it neat when we show up in Scripture? He's talking about us. He's going, Thomas, you got to see and believe, but blessed are those in 2017 who didn't get a chance to see me with their physical eyes, and yet they still believe. Well, I kind of threw in a little bit of that there. Here's another interesting little side note. Jesus, he's in his glorified body, right? It's after the resurrection, his glorified body. In other words, they said the doors were locked. He didn't need to come in through the door. He just appeared there. We're going to have the same kind of glorified bodies when we resurrect. We're going to have physical bodies, but we're not going to be limited the same way as we are now. But here's something interesting. So Jesus, in his glorified body after the resurrection, he was physical. Thomas could touch him. But here's something interesting. He still had those marks, the nail marks in his hands. He still had that spear mark in his side. He's going to carry that for eternity. I've heard this said, that the only imperfect thing that's going to be in heaven is going to be Jesus, because he's going to still carry those marks of the crucifixion with him. That's kind of an interesting thought. Throughout eternity, when we see Jesus, we're going to be reminded that we're only there. We only get to be there because of what he was willing to do for us on the cross. What an awesome thing that is. That has nothing to do with the message today. Just want to throw that in. But Jesus is so awesome in the way he dealt with Thomas, isn't he? I mean, how did he handle Thomas? He didn't say, Thomas, you idiot. How could you be such an idiot? Why? How can you doubt me? You're such a loser, Thomas. Get away from me, Thomas. I don't want to have anything to do with somebody who doesn't believe in me. No. Jesus wasn't turned off. He wasn't freaked out by Thomas's doubt. Instead, he said, all right, Thomas, let's face this together. Let's face this head on together. If you're willing to check this out, Thomas, I will let you see what you need to see for you to believe. If you're willing, Thomas. He invited Thomas, come on over. If you're willing, Thomas, go ahead. Touch these nail marks. Put your hand in my side. I'll tell you, in the same way, Jesus knows your doubts. He knew Thomas's doubts. That's why right when he got there, he said, all right, Thomas, come on over here, buddy. Let's deal with this. He knows your doubts too. Those doubts that you don't feel like you want to share with anybody. Those doubts that maybe you have just when you're laying in bed at night. Those doubts you have when you get frustrated. He knows your doubts. And if you're willing, I believe God will help you see everything you need to see to overcome your doubts. And I'm not saying it's like, okay, God, I'm going to jump off this bridge, and if you're real, then don't let me hit the water kind of stuff. But if you are willing to say, God, I need your help with this. I'm struggling, and you bring your doubts. And if you're willing, he's going to help you see everything you need to see to help you work through your doubts. God's not scared. He's not threatened by your doubts. God is greater than your doubt. But maybe for you, your doubt is more about whether it's really worth it to live God's way. I think this is pretty common among Christians. We struggle sometimes with whether it's worth it to live life as a Christian. Is it really worth it? Maybe you look around and it seems like people who aren't even trying at all to live for God, man, they've just got it made. It seems like they're free of a lot of the problems that you're struggling with. And you're just going, what's up with this? Why is this happening this way? You're trying hard to live for God and you're wondering, maybe it's better if I just give up. Is this even worth it to try to live for God? Well, I'll tell you, there was a guy in the Bible who struggled with that. There's a guy in the Bible in the Old Testament who had these same feelings. His name was Asaph. Okay, and Asaph was a Levite, which means he was set apart for priestly duties, leading the people in worship. Okay, so and his specific duty was that of a choir leader. He was like their sang park. He was a choir leader. Okay, and he writes this poem. He writes this poem, and many of those poems were turned into songs, and since he was a choir leader, chances are that his poem, he probably took his choir and said, "Hey, I wrote this poem on, you guys were going to sing it." And I would imagine, this, and when you read it, you're going to see why I say this, is probably, it's kind of like a country song here. Country song, you know, where, like, my girl left me, my dog died, my truck blew up. Yeehaw, you know, whatever. But that's kind of a little bit like this poem that he wrote. And it's recorded in the Psalms. It's one of my all-time favorite Psalms. And the reason being is because it's so real. It's so authentic. It kind of hits a chord with, I think, what a lot of people struggle with. And it's Psalm 73. Turn to Psalm 73. It says a psalm of Asaph, and then look at verse 1. Truly God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped, for I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. So he's saying, I believe God is good, but you know what? I started to have doubts. I started to doubt the goodness of God. I started to doubt. In fact, he goes on to say in verses 3 through 9. Well, let's look at those real quick. Verses 3 through 9. He says, "For I was envious of the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For they have no pangs until death. Their bodies are fat and sleek." He means that in a good way. "They are not in trouble as others are. They are not stricken like the rest of mankind. Therefore, pride is their necklace. Violence covers them as a garment. Their eyes swell out through fatness. Their hearts overflow with follies. They scoff and speak with malice. Loftily, they threaten oppression. They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongue struts through the earth." He's just saying, you know what? I look at the ungodly, and it looks like they're just prospering beyond measure. The ungodly seems like their lives are painless. To him, it seems like they're strong, they're healthy, they're wealthy. The ungodly don't seem to have any of the problems, and they seem to have everything that they want. You ever feel that way? You ever struggle with those feelings? Look at what he says in verse 13. This is what it drove him to. Verse 13. "All in vain I have kept my heart clean and washed my hands in innocence. For all the day long I have been stricken and rebuked every morning." He's saying, maybe it's not worth it. Maybe I'm following God and it's all in vain. Maybe this is a big waste of my time to try to live for God. That's what he was feeling. That's what he was struggling with. This is his poem. And so look at what he says in verse 16. He says, "But when I thought how to understand all this, it seemed to me a wearisome task." He's going, I can't wrap my brain around this. I'm just frustrated. I can't understand it. I find myself doubting God. Doubting whether he's even good. Doubting whether this is even worth it to follow after God. Is it worth it? But then look at verse 17. He's saying, it seemed like a wearisome task until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I discerned their end. I look around, the wicked seem like they got it all going on, and it seems like I'm wasting my time until I go into the sanctuary of God. Until I draw close to God, until I turn my attention back to God, until I go in the sanctuary of God, then I'm reminded of how great God is. Then I remembered that these ungodly people who care nothing about God, it seems like they got it all together. It seems like life is so great for them now. And maybe it is great for them now, but you know what? I realized where they're headed. I realized that what they're headed for is destruction. That their end is not going to be any good at all. They might have it going good now, but their end isn't going to be any good at all. Then look at verse 23. "Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterwards, you will receive me into glory." That is an awesome little turn of mindset there. But what's also good about that is it shows that you know what he's saying. Yeah, I was. You know what? I almost slipped. My mindset was off. I thought that the ungodly had it better than me. In fact, I was envious of them, and I almost gave up on God and went after the things they were going after because I wanted what the kind of life they have. He goes, but then I came into to the presence of the Lord, and everything changed. And you know what he said? And God, I've been with you, and you've held my hand. You held my hand right through my doubts. You held my hand right through the struggles. God doesn't reject you because you have doubts. In fact, he wants to draw you in even closer. That's what he wants to do when you're having doubts. He wants you to see and be reminded of his greatness so that you can see that he's greater than your doubts. So I'll tell you, if you're having doubts today, if you're asking whether it's worth it to even live for God, the first thing you need to do is be reminded of how great God is. Be reminded of how great God is. You need to focus on the greatness of God. And you know what? If you do that, you're going to realize what Asaph realized. And look at what he realized in verse 25. He said, "Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you will perish, but you put an end to everyone who is unfaithful to you. But for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works." That is awesome. He came to realize that, you know what, God, you are good. You are mighty. You are greater than my doubts. And he's saying, he came to the point, he says, you know what, whom have I in heaven but you? And on the earth, there is nothing I desire that's better than you. This earth doesn't have anything that I want more than I want you. Because you're greater than all of it. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeits his soul? That's what Asaph realized. And that's what you'll be reminded of. That's what you'll realize if you'll take your doubts to him. But you know, sometimes our emotions can just get the best of us. They really can. Sometimes our emotions can just lead us to doubt. We get frustrated. We get scared. We get disappointed in whatever's going on. And it can lead us to begin to doubt God, doubt his love for us, doubt his ability to bring a good solution to the problem in front of us. We just begin to doubt. In fact, there's another guy here I want you to take a look at in Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. I think this is where a lot of us find ourselves too sometimes. In Mark chapter 9, There's a guy whose son, his son was plagued by an evil spirit. Okay, he was demon possessed. His son, and he brought his boy to some of Jesus' disciples, and they tried to cast out the demon, and it didn't work. It didn't happen. And so the guy says, "All right, I'm going to Jesus." And so brings his son to Jesus, and look at verse 20. And they brought the boy to him, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground, he rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus said to the father, "How long has it been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And he often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him." So this demon was trying to kill him by throwing him into fire and into water. "But if you can do," here's his, "but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can," did you just say, "if I can"? Did you just say, "if you can"? "All things are possible for him who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe, help my unbelief." And when Jesus saw that, the crowd came running. He rebuked the unclean spirit, and Jesus cast it out. So he brings this and he just says, you know, this has been happening since he was a child, and we're just, you know, Lord, we're so desperate. If you can do anything, please help us. And Jesus just says, "If I can?" Do you know who you're talking to here? Everything's possible. If you believe. I think we find ourselves there a lot, where we just say, you know, in our heads, yeah, we know, God, that you're great and all that, but if you can just help me here, if you just, you know, lead me, or if you can give me wisdom, and we just have that belief, but then we start doubting because of our emotions. Our emotions come in, and we face this problem, and all of a sudden, we're just not quite sure. We just want to have an open hand and let God have it, or we just don't know. We want to trust his solution, and we think we got to get in there and help take care of it, or we just don't know if we can trust him to provide for us, and we begin to doubt because of those emotions. But we need to be like that father who said, yeah, God, I do believe, but I'm struggling too. I need you to help me with my unbelief. Yeah, I do have a little bit of faith, but I want to have more. I want to have more faith. I want to trust you more. I want to trust you with everything, but I'm not there yet. It's kind of what the dad just said to Jesus. I believe, but help my unbelief. Help that part of me that doesn't fully trust you yet. That's how we got to come to the Lord with our doubts. God is greater than your doubts. He can handle it. He's not afraid of your doubts. He won't push you away because you have doubts. He's ready and willing to help you through it. So when you struggle with doubt, here's what I think we need to do. When we struggle with doubt, here's what we need to do. First thing we do, we need to be honest with God about it. We need to just be honest with God about it. He knows your doubts anyway. Let's be like that father. Yeah, I do kind of believe, but you know what? I'm having a problem here. God, I don't fully trust you. I want to, but I don't. And be honest with God about your doubts. Bring your doubts to him. And then the second thing we need to do is you need to move toward God and not away from him. When we have doubts, a lot of times we let it drive us away from God. We let that doubt turn into denial, and we let it drive us further away from God instead of saying, you know what, God, I'm struggling right now, but I want to believe. I want to have more faith in you. I want to have more trust in you. You know what God says in his word so many times? He says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. That's what he wants you to do with your doubt. He's going, don't run away from me. Bring those doubts over here and let's work through them. You seek me with all of your heart, you're going to find me. And then lastly, we need to spend time focusing on the greatness of God. When we focus on the greatness of God, man, that helps us with our doubt. Read it in his word. Get into the word and just see how great God is. See the kinds of things he can do. Not only that, but remind yourself of the ways that he's already shown up in your life, the way he's already shown his goodness to you, the way he's already shown his power and his greatness to you. Talk to other people about that. Come and let's sing praises to him together. By the way, sorry that was out. You guys over here have to look all the way over there. We'll be dealing with that soon. Spend some time focusing on the greatness of God. This is what we need to do. You got doubts? I think we all kind of are there sometimes. We all kind of struggle at times with doubt to some degree. And if you get there sometime, I just want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to be honest with God about it. Just be honest and upfront. Number two, move towards God and not away from him. And number three, spend time focusing on the greatness of God. And he's going to help you work through those doubts. And come to the place where each of those, that's what each of those people did. I mean, if you think back, Asaph, he said, man, I was struggling with all this doubt. And then until what? I came into the sanctuary of the Lord. Until I came back to the Lord. Thomas, you know, he didn't, I'm not going to see, I'm not going to believe until, and Jesus said, okay, come on over here, Thomas. Go ahead, put your fingers there. He drew close to Jesus. And then you got this father who's like, man, we're trying to get rid of it and we're trying to deal with this struggle of my son. And then Jesus, you know, he brings, I'm going to bring him to Jesus. Each of those people, you know how they dealt with their doubts? They moved towards Jesus. They moved towards God. They drew closer to him. And if you do that, you're going to come to the realization that who am I in heaven but you? And the earth has nothing I desire more than you. Let's pray. God, I'm just thankful that you're so patient with us. That, Lord, when we have doubts, and I know there's some that were brought into this room this morning. When we have those doubts, you don't push us away. You don't make us feel like losers. You just want us to bring those doubts to you. And you want to help work through those with us. And I pray, God, for anyone here today who isn't quite sure that you're real, isn't quite sure what they've been told about you is true, isn't quite sure that they're ready to put their faith in something they can't, someone they can't see or touch. And I pray, Lord, that you'd open their hearts to your truth. I pray your Holy Spirit would just minister to their spirit and help them see what they need to see to trust you and to put their faith in you. And I pray, God, they'd be willing to take those doubts to you rather than let those doubts move them further from you. And Lord, I pray for those, God, who they know you're real. They've experienced you in their life, but they just have moments of struggle where they want to grab a hold of a problem or a situation, and they just have trouble trusting you. They have trouble believing that you're going to bring something good for them. They maybe wonder sometimes if you're missing what's going on in their life. And I pray, God, they bring those doubts to you as well. They be honest with you about them. That they bring them to you and they'd focus on your greatness. We thank you that you're a great God. You're greater than our doubts. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
Till I am a soul on fire.